Yari? क्या सब लोग मेरी आवाज सुन रहे हैं? अच्छा, बाहर जो हमारे मेहमान खड़े हुए हैं, मैं उनसे आग्रह करता हूं कि वो ऑडिटोरियम में आ जाएं। मुख्य अतिथि आ गए हैं, हम लोग अपना कार्यक्रम शुरू करने जा रहे हैं। मित्रों नमस्कार, हमारे बहुत से मेहमान आज के इस कार्यक्रम में हमारे आग्रह पर यहाँ आए हैं, मैं उन सब का अभिवादन करता हूँ। और आज के कार्यक्रम के मुख्य अतिथि प्रोफेसर एस के सोपोरी, जवाहरलाल नेहरू विश्वविद्यालय के कुलपति हैं, वो यहाँ आ गए हैं हमारे साथ, हम उनका भी करतल ध्वनि से स्वागत करते हैं। विश्वविद्यालय का 26वां स्थापना दिवस समारोह शुरू हो रहा है। 19 नवंबर कई कारणों से बहुत महत्वपूर्ण दिन है। विश्वविद्यालय की स्थापना श्रीमती इंदिरा गांधी के नाम पर हुई थी, आज श्रीमती इंदिरा गांधी का जन्मदिन भी है, और ये एक सुंदर संयोग है कि विश्वविद्यालय की स्थापना और श्रीमती इंदिरा गांधी का जन्मदिन एक ही दिन पड़ता है। 26वां स्थापना दिवस समारोह है, 25 वर्ष हम लोग पूरे कर चुके हैं, एक लंबा समय विश्वविद्यालय ने बिताया है, और 25 वर्षों में विश्वविद्यालय ने जो प्रगति की है उसका लेखा जोखा देने का ये समय नहीं है। मैं केवल आपको ये बताना चाहता हूँ कि यह विश्वविद्यालय एक छोटी सी इकाई से 1985 में शुरू होकर इस समय मेगा यूनिवर्सिटी के तौर पर जा अपनी पहचान बना चुका है। भारतवर्ष में तो हर जगह इंदिरा गांधी राष्ट्रीय मुक्त विश्वविद्यालय की पहचान बनी हुई है, लेकिन भारतवर्ष के बाहर भी अंतर्राष्ट्रीय स्तर पर भी इंदिरा गांधी राष्ट्रीय मुक्त विश्वविद्यालय एक जाना पहचाना चिरपरिचित नाम हो चुका है। स्पष्ट है कि ये सब हमारे अध्यापकों, अन्य कर्मचारियों और विद्यार्थियों के इस विश्वविद्यालय के साथ जुड़ाव के कारण हो सका है। सभी लोग विश्वविद्यालय की इस प्रगति में भागीदार हैं, सभी लोग विश्वविद्यालय की इस अभूतपूर्व प्रगति के लिए साधुवाद के भी हकदार हैं। ये विश्वविद्यालय दूर शिक्षा के केंद्र में न केवल भारतवर्ष में बल्कि सारे विश्व में जो पहचान बना सका है, उसका प्रमुख कारण ये है कि विश्वविद्यालय अपने कार्यक्रमों के माध्यम से उच्च शिक्षा के क्षेत्र में गुणवत्ता वाले कार्यक्रमों के लिए जाना जाता है। हमारे मुख्य अतिथि आज इसी विषय पर अपना व्याख्यान भी देने जा रहे हैं, और मैं आशा करता हूं कि दूर शिक्षा के क्षेत्र में होने वाली प्रगति का कुछ न कुछ जिक्र उनके व्याख्यान में हमें सुनने को अवश्य मिलेगा। अभी विश्वविद्यालय ने पिछले वर्ष अपना रजत जयंती समारोह मनाया था बहुत धूमधाम से, और प्रायः ही अपेक्षा की जाती है कि रजत जयंती के बाद एक तरह का ठहराव आ जाता है, पर यहाँ उपस्थित मेहमानों को और विद्यार्थियों और अन्य अध्यापक कर्मचारी वर्ग को देखकर मेरा मन दोबारा खुशी से भर उठा। जिस तरह से रजत जयंती वर्ष में सबने एक साथ मिलकर विश्वविद्यालय की प्रगति का लेखा जोखा लिया था और सब सहभागी हुए थे, बिल्कुल उसी तरह से आज भी ये ऑडिटोरियम भर गया है पूरी तरह से। मैं कुलपति जी से केवल ये आग्रह कर सकता हूँ कि विश्वविद्यालय के विद्यार्थियों की और अध्यापक और कर्मचारी वर्ग की संख्या को देखते हुए अब ये ऑडिटोरियम छोटा पड़ने लगा है, और यदि उन्हें समय मिले तो वो कृपया इसको बड़ा करने का प्रयास मानव संसाधन विकास मंत्रालय के साथ मिलकर करें। प्रोफेसर सोपोरी बहुत जाना पहचाना नाम है, जवाहरलाल नेहरू विश्वविद्यालय के कुलपति भी रहे हैं, कुलपति हैं इस समय, और एक स्वनामधन्य वैज्ञानिक भी हैं। हम लोग इस कार्यक्रम की शुरुआत प्रोफेसर सोपोरी का अभिनंदन करके करते हैं। मैं अपने सहयोगियों से ये आग्रह करता हूँ कि वो सबसे पहले एक छोटा सा गमला प्रोफेसर सोपोरी को भेंट करें, पर्यावरण की चिंता के चलते अब हम लोगों ने बुके देना बंद कर दिया है और इस तरह के गमलों से अब हम लोग अपने मेहमानों का स्वागत करते हैं। मुख्य अतिथि एक विश्वविद्यालय की परंपरा रही है कि स्थापना दिवस के इस अवसर पर हम मुख्य अतिथि से स्थापना दिवस व्याख्यान भी दिलवाते हैं। जैसा पीछे बैकड्रॉप में लिखा हुआ है, हमारे मुख्य अतिथि बहुत जल्दी वो व्याख्यान देंगे, पर उसके पहले हम मुख्य अतिथि का एक शॉल पहनाकर परंपरागत रीति से दोबारा स्वागत करेंगे। और आप सब भी साक्षी रहे हैं, मैं भी विश्वविद्यालय में अब लगभग 2 दशकों से अध्यापक के रूप में कार्यरत हूं। इस तरह के तमाम कार्यक्रमों की शुरुआत हम लोग दीप प्रज्वलित करके करते हैं। मैं अपने साथियों से आग्रह करता हूं कि वो सभी अतिथियों को, मेहमानों को जो डायस पर बैठे हुए हैं, लेकर दीप के पास जाएँ और विधिवत रूप से दीप प्रज्वलित करवाएँ। मुझे मालूम है कि आप सब लोग बहुत व्यग्रता से मुख्य अतिथि के व्याख्यान की प्रतीक्षा कर रहे हैं, पर कुलपति के आग्रह से और आपसी परामर्श से हम लोगों ने एक अभिनव शुरुआत इस वर्ष के स्थापना दिवस समारोह पे करने का प्रयास किया है। ये शुरुआत है विश्वविद्यालय के कर्मचारी वर्ग द्वारा विश्वविद्यालय के प्रति निष्ठा व्यक्त करने का एक फॉर्मल प्रयास। मैं ऑडिटोरियम में हमारे साथी एक फाउंडेशन डे प्लेज वाला कार्ड सबको वितरित कर रहे हैं, सबको वो कार्ड मिल जाएगा। मैं वो प्लेज जो स्थापना दिवस समारोह पर हम लोगों ने तैयार की है आपके सामने पढ़ता हूं और ये आशा करता हूं कि आप इसमें सम्मिलित होंगे। जाहिर है कि आप मेरे साथ बोलकर इसमें सम्मिलित नहीं होंगे, पर मैं ये मानता हूं कि हमारे अध्यापक और कर्मचारी वर्ग इस प्लेज से सहमत होंगे। सभी को ये कार्ड भी जल्दी से मिल जाएगा, कार्यक्रम में देर न हो इसलिए मैं ये प्लेज आपको पढ़ करके सुनाता हूं। अंग्रेजी और हिंदी दोनों में ये शपथ है और जाहिर है कि ये शपथ कर्मचारी वर्ग द्वारा, अध्यापक वर्ग द्वारा विश्वविद्यालय के प्रति उस निष्ठा की बात करती है जिस निष्ठा के चलते विश्वविद्यालय इस मकाम तक पहुंचा है। 25 वर्षों की उपलब्धियों पर अगर हमें गर्व है तो वो गर्व इसी प्लेज के, जो हम लोगों ने कभी फॉर्मल तरीके से ली नहीं, लेकिन इसी प्लेज के चलते वो विश्वविद्यालय को हम यहां तक लेकर के आए हैं। पहले मैं अंग्रेजी में पढ़ता हूं फाउंडेशन डे प्लेज। आई सॉलेमली प्लेज टू सर्व my institution IGNOU with honesty, dedication and sincerity. जाहिर है कि इन तीनों शब्दों के प्रति हमारी भी पूरी सहमति है, आपकी भी सहमति होगी, ऑनेस्टी, डेडिकेशन एंड सिंसियरिटी। हिंदी में इसका अनुवाद है, मैं सत्यनिष्ठा से ये शपथ लेता हूं कि अपनी संस्था इग्नू की सदैव ईमानदारी, समर्पण व सच्चाई के साथ सेवा करूंगा। इस शपथ के बाद हम लोग अपना कार्यक्रम शुरू करते हैं। मुख्य अतिथि यहाँ पर आ चुके हैं, मैं आग्रह करता हूँ कि मुख्य अतिथि का परिचय दिया जाए और उसके पश्चात मुख्य अतिथि का फॉर्मल वेलकम प्रोफेसर परवीन सिंक्लेयर से हम लोग करवाएंगे।
प्रोफेसर सुधीर कुमार सुपोरी इज अ डिस्टिंग्विश्ड साइंटिस्ट ऑफ आर कंट्री एंड एन एमिनेंट प्लांट मॉलिक्यूलर बायोलॉजिस्ट ऑफ इंटरनेशनल रिप्यूट। हिज टीचिंग एंड रिसर्च करियर स्पैन्स ओवर 37 ईयर्स एंड बिफोर टेकिंग चार्ज एज द वाइस चांसलर ऑफ द जवाहरलाल नेहरू यूनिवर्सिटी ही हैज सर्व्ड एज द ग्रुप लीडर एट द इंटरनेशनल सेंटर फॉर जेनेटिक इंजीनियरिंग and biotechnology from 1997 to 2010. Professor Sopory has been awarded various national and international honors for his contribution to scientific research and teaching. To name a few are the Bhatnagar Award of CSIR, Birbal Sahani Medal of Botanical Society, and most importantly, the honor of Padma Shri. Also, in 2010, he has been the first Indian to receive the corresponding membership award of American Society for Plant Biology. Now, I would request Professor Parveen Sinclair to please welcome the chief guest.
Thank you. Good afternoon, Professor Sopory, the Vice Chancellor Professor Aslam, Tolia Ji, all my colleagues here and at all the regional centers. I'm glad we're together on this 26th Foundation Day. A warm welcome to all of you. Today, we plan to have a short function focusing on higher education. Professor Sopory's life has been spent, I think right from 73 on, yeah, in higher education teaching molecular biology. He is actually a member of the IGNOU family willy-nilly from our early years on, when he helped us design some materials in the life sciences. I don't know if he remembers that, but we do. Those programs are, of course, some of them developed, some still in the pipeline, some being revised. Professor Sopory has been very kind to agree to this, to join us today as the head of a sister university. We're all functioning together for improving the higher education scenario of the country, the paridrishya in Hindi. He's been, of course, he's a member of all the academies, a fellow of all the academies, INSA, NAS, and somewhere where I have been, and I enjoy it very much, Trieste, the TWAS also is a fellow of. Mr. Bhal has just joined us. Welcome, Mr. Bhal. The Chief Managing Director of the National Finance Handicapped and Development Corporation, which is part of the wing of the Ministry of Social Justice for helping the handicapped develop themselves and develop careers for themselves. He is, of course, originally from the IIS. Am I right, sir? Yeah. Welcome. And again, a warm welcome to all of you. I hope we have a nice time today. Thank you.
मैं प्रोफेसर Sopory से अनुरोध करता हूं कि वो कृपया अपना व्याख्यान दे।
Professor Aslam, Vice-Chancellor of IGNOU, Shri Harsh Bahal, Professor Parveen Sinclair, U.S. Tolia Ji, distinguished guests, staff of IGNOU, faculty of IGNOU, students, ladies and gentlemen. In fact, I feel highly privileged and honored to have been invited to join you on the 26th Foundation Day of your university. Firstly, my congratulations to all the members of the university for having played an important national responsibility in giving access to education and to increase the overall GR in the country. As was mentioned by Professor Parveen, I have been associated with IGNOU in its early days. Thanks to Dr. Taneja, who is in the audience here, and her colleagues in the Life Sciences Department, I was part of the team that designed and prepared courses related to plant biology, especially plant physiology, and other reading material. And I was also a member of some of the committees later on. Today, of course, I'm coming to this campus after a very, very long time. I hope the next time I come, the road will be perfect to reach here. IGNOU and JNU have something in common. Both are named after the great state persons, visionaries, and the former prime ministers of the country. Both supported education and science as a means for the transformation of our society. Mrs. Indira Gandhi said, and that's what is inscribed on your emblem, education is a liberating force, and in our age, it is also a democratizing force, cutting across the barriers of caste and class, smoothing out inequalities imposed by birth and other circumstances. And in the Jawaharlal Nehru University, the emblem states, which is also a quote from Jawaharlal Nehru, a university stands for humanism, for tolerance, for reasons, for the adventure of ideas, and for the search of truth. It stands for the onward march of the human race towards ever higher objectives. If the universities discharge their duties educatively, then it is well within the nation and the people. The question today which we face is, have we come up to the expectations of both Mrs. Indira Gandhi and Pandit Nehru? Are we discharging our duties educatively? Being a scientist by profession, I have myself not done any serious analysis on this topic. What I'm going to say a few words in this context is as a general educationist and one who is concerned with various issues of higher education. Currently, higher education is imparted to the students of this country through around 550 degree awarding institutes, 42 central universities, and about 240 state and other universities. In addition to that, we have many IITs, NITs, new ICERs, and others which have been added during the last planned period. Despite this massive expansion that has taken place in the field of education in the last planned period and earlier, access to higher education is still an unfulfilled aspiration of Indian youth, whose percentage of the total Indian population is ever increasing. I was reading somewhere, it states that over 5.4 million graduates and 1 million postgraduates have desired to study further. How do we then meet the expectations of our young generation? I'm sure many of you will have read about the report of Knowledge Commission, which was brought out some years, a couple of years back, and that said that if you have to meet the aspirations of this youth, we'll have to start with at least 1,500 universities, and these 1,500 universities will have to come in force by the year 2015. a task impossible at the moment to do. Now, in order to meet this task, we know that many private sectors have come up in the field of education, who are setting up new universities and institutions. And some of these are, of course, well established. However, many of these are in the business of teaching, maybe good teaching, but most of these are surely not involved in generating knowledge. Also, these private universities and institutions, they are not easily accessible to the weaker sections of the society. And it is in this context, I think, IGNOU has played a very, very important and major role by bringing education to the doorfront of the people, of the students, who would not have been, for whom it would not have been possible to get education otherwise. Now, accessibility to education is a subject which at JNU we have taken rather seriously. Our admission policy, right from its inception, had factored in mechanisms to give access to socially and economically weaker sections of the society. We also adopted the new OBC policy. Our gender policy has also helped us to achieve this year an equal ratio of female and boy students, male and boy students. We have also developed courses this year to empower the weaker students with language and communication and IT related skills. It's not only good to that you take the students in and not empower them with extra educational skills. While expansion and accessibility are the issues that we had to deal with, even in future years, a major concern, and that's the concern of this 12th plan period in the Planning Commission where I have been going, I've been asking this question, how to foster excellence in teaching and research. So we have to develop specific policies in this regard. How do you maintain the standards, higher standards of teaching and research? One of the major problems which I find that the architecture of the course structure which we have is still very rigid in most of the colleges and the universities. We bind the students to a specific stream at a very early age without giving them an opportunity to change at a later stage. We make them choose career for life and not life for career. Even though we have a large number of central and state universities, the knowledge generation and research output in sciences, social sciences, and even humanities is not adequate. Although some of our universities have shown better performance, yet many of these have not been able to make it up to the world ranking universities. In fact, the other day there was a meeting, remember, in Planning Commission, they were saying none of the Indian universities comes even up to 300 or 400 top world ranking universities. This is a cause of concern. And this really needs analysis. And some serious measures need to be taken towards improvement of our productivity, both qualitatively as well as quantitatively. I sometimes feel even in the field of technologies, except a few IITs, all our regional engineering colleges or medical colleges, if you look at, we have just been able to train these people to adapt to the new tools, to the new gadgets and technology, but we ourselves have not been able to innovate except in the low technology sector. Of course, there are exceptions in the area of space research or in agriculture where some good strides have been made in this country. To me, excellence and performance will remain a major concern for most of the universities for many years to come. And to overcome this, we probably need to relook I personally feel we need to relook at our recruitment and appointment policies at all levels of entry, in the teaching as well as in the administration. We must check the carrying capacity of each unit in terms of university institute, and this should be very properly planned. Too thin and too obese organizations will show disease symptoms. Every one component of the university, be it teachers, staff, administrators and students, must be responsible and accountable. And I'm happy that IGNOU faculty, staff and students have just taken an oath that they will abide by these things. I understand in the 12th plan, a major emphasis will be on the teacher, who I feel is the central figure and the cornerstone of education system. Rabindranath Tagore also once remarked, a teacher can never truly teach unless he is still learning himself. Just as a lamp can never light another lamp unless it continues to burn itself. Universities are a dynamic system where students come and go. This dynamism in the university brings new culture and new ideas, which most of the time, which I find, teachers, maybe even administrators, are unable to tap or let them bloom due to rigid ideas and compartmentalized course and research structure. There is more emphasis on transmitting knowledge and less emphasis on analyzing the gained knowledge and coupling it with one's own experience, resulting in the generation of new knowledge. Learning and teaching has been emphasized in our culture, our old Indian culture, also as essential for healthy physical, mental, intellectual and spiritual upbringing. Sri Aurobindo, a great Indian philosopher, has said, each human being is a self-developing soul. The educational curriculum should be designed in such a way that it should enable and help the learner to educate himself, and developing his own intellectual and moral aesthetic capabilities, and grow as a better human being. It should awaken the darkened areas and awaken the dormant centers of the brain. The objectives of education thus is self-development and development of others and the society. To build a system of education worthy of its commitment to society, one has to have moral and ethical standards in place. The knowledge must therefore spread beyond self. Being a botanist, I put it this example like this. Like a tree, we must keep our roots in our traditions and culture, spread our branches in the air of modern education, and set flowers that will attract others on our side, and set seeds which will spread and germinate in and outside the borders of one's parameters and boundaries. In this country, where we have to attend to many global issues like climate change, water, energy, peaceful coexistence and development based on new knowledge, it is important that higher education and knowledge must transcend the national boundaries. It is in this context that one is emphasizing on the global education programs and in developing linkages with institutions within and outside India. Lastly, I must admit that I have many questions in mind. One can keep going on this, for which I do not have any simple answers. To give a few examples, before partition and even immediately after independence, the performance of many universities was very good. Many scientists' contributions were well recognized world over. The standard of teaching and research was high. I do not want to name any one university or institute in particular, but the question is, why these universities could not improve further or even sustain their excellence, rather one always sees a downward trend. Why do we have not been able to create new frontiers of knowledge or even catch up with them? This is especially when our training is so good that when our students or even our teachers, they go abroad, they innovate and generate novel ideas. The third thing is why we have not been able to bring value to the education systems. I can go on, I have so many questions, but those come in your mind. In addition to expanding our education, institutions creating good opportunities of education for all the sections of society, or improving methodologies and facilitate to create excellence in teaching and research, I feel there is a need to create greater education, temper and culture in this country. Together with generating financial and material support and sensitizing the central and state organization to the needs of colleges and universities, teachers and students, and above all of the nation. Mr. M.C. Chagla was Minister for Education, once said, "I wish I were both Education Minister and Finance Minister together. And then I could write checks for education. But I am not. I have to beg. Please give me some money for education." He says, "I would like to beg because I think this is the greatest national activity that we can have." I end with a quote from Rabindranath Tagore, whose 150th anniversary we are all celebrating this year. He said, that was long back when he mentioned this, "For some time past, education has lacked idealism in its mere exercise of an intellect which has no depth of sentiment. The one desire that we produce in the heart of the students has been an ambition to win success in the world, not to reach some inner standard of perfection, not to obtain self-emancipation." So I feel there are a lot of things which higher education still has to achieve. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Sopory. This was a very perceptive address, and we are really grateful for your emphasis on the moral, ethical, and ideational aspects of education. These are the sustaining features of education. Also, we are grateful for not presenting such a gloomy picture of the current higher educational scenario in India, which normally is the bane of most of our presenters. Professor Sopory has to be given a memento from the university. I request the Vice-Chancellor, Professor Aslam, to...
Today we have amongst us Mr. Harsh Behel, Chairman and Managing Director, National Handicapped Finance and Development Corporation. Sir, as a token of respect, we would like to offer a pot from IGNOU's own nursery. Mr. Behel is with us as special guest to support the cause of education for the differently abled students of IGNOU. Now I would request Mr. Behel to please come and deliver the address.
Professor S.K. Sopory, Vice-Chancellor, GNU. Professor M. Aslam, Vice-Chancellor, IGNOU, U.S. Tholiyaji, Registrar, IGNOU, Professor Praveen Sinclair, Pro Vice Chancellor, and friends. The National Handicapped Finance and Development Corporation was set up by the Ministry of Social Justice and Empowerment, Government of India, in 1997. The objective of this corporation is to serve as a catalyst in the economic development of PWDs by helping them in setting up self-employment ventures. Thus, the vision of NHFDC is to empower the disabled persons in order to break away from the dependence on others and also from their depressed economic social conditions. This is only possible by engaging themselves in productive ventures and thus help themselves to move up the social and economic ladder with dignity and pride. The National Handicapped Finance and Development Corporation provides concessional credit to persons with disabilities all over India through its channelizing agencies in the states and UTs. The concessional credit is provided up to Rs. 25 lakhs. A special rebate of 1% is provided to women beneficiaries. Recently, NHFDC has taken several initiatives to expand the outreach of its activities in favor of persons with disabilities, particularly in the area of higher education. These are 1,000 new scholarships under trust fund have been announced by the government for students with disabilities pursuing technical professional courses at graduate and PG level. Under this scheme, a student with visual or hearing disability is also provided one-time facility of aids and appliances. The scholarship scheme is being implemented from the current academic year itself. This scholarship includes total fee reimbursement, books and stationery allowance, and maintenance allowance. Under the scholarship scheme, a student is expected to receive a scholarship amount of ₹60,000 and above in a year. This scholarship is automatically renewed every year during the currency of professional and technical course. This scholarship scheme is also applicable to distance education under the esteemed universities like IGNOU. In addition to above, 500 national scholarships are awarded each year to eligible students with disabilities for pursuing higher academic, professional or technical qualifications. This scholarship is also available to those students who are pursuing PhD or MPhil degrees. In order to give impetus to students with disabilities for pursuing higher education, NHFDC has further reduced the interest rate on education loan. The interest on education loan is 4% per annum for male students and 3.5% per annum for female students. The education loan is now available up to Rs. 10 lakhs for studies within the country and up to Rs. 20 lakhs for studies abroad. To ensure that more and more young professionals with disabilities join the mainstream activities of the nation, a unique scheme for young professionals have been introduced. This will help our architects, doctors, engineers, lawyers, etc. to pursue their professional activities. A concessional credit is available to these young professionals for their projects up to Rs. 25 lakhs at the interest rate between 4% per annum to 8% per annum. The detailed information on these scholarships and other scheme is available at NHFDC website. It will be our endeavor to cover as many handicapped students as possible, and you are also welcome to help the handicapped persons through us. I would particularly request Professor Aslam to popularize these schemes. We have already received 10 applications for the scholarships for the current year. I am very glad to inform you that all these 10 scholarships will be awarded this year itself as per procedure. Thank you.
Bhal sahab, aapka bahut bahut dhanyabad. Vishwavidyalay ke differently abled students ke liye jo initiative aapke corporation ne liya hai aur jiski wajah se hamare vishwavidyalay ke vidyarthiyon ko badi sahayata milegi, hum aapke aabhari hain. इस समय ऑडिटोरियम में छोटे छोटे बच्चे आ गए हैं, वो सांस्कृतिक कार्यक्रम पेश करेंगे. मैं बच्चों से ये रिक्वेस्ट करता हूँ, चुप बैठिए, आपको अच्छा लगेगा. बहुत कम अवसर ऐसे होते हैं जब इस स्थान से खड़े होकर आपको किसी ऐसे व्यक्ति को कुलपति के रूप में एड्रेस करने के लिए बुलाना हो जो आपके अपने अंदर से हो। प्रोफेसर असलम हमारे अंदर से हैं, हमारे साथी हैं, विश्वविद्यालय के वाइस चांसलर हैं। मैं ये अवसर का लाभ उठाना चाहता हूं, उनसे रिक्वेस्ट करना चाहता हूं कि वो प्लीज़ आएं और हम लोगों से बातचीत करें।
Respected Professor Sopory Sahib, Vice-Chancellor Jawaharlal Nehru University, and our distinguished chief guest today, Mr. Harsh Bahl, Chairman and Managing Director, and NFHDS, Professor Sinclair, is the Chairman of the Organizing Committee for this function, Mr. Taulia, distinguished guests and my colleagues. At the very outset, I'm grateful to our chief guest, Professor Sopory, to have agreed to deliver this 26th Foundation Day lecture today. It was on a very short notice that he readily agreed to be with us and deliver this lecture. In spite of the fact that within 1 hour he has a very, very important meeting to attend. I think to me it was a scholarly presentation from a distinguished head of the neighboring institution. His emphasis on quality of education, I think, provided us a common agenda to work together. He raised certain pertinent questions in his presentation for us to ponder. I think we will certainly work together to improve the quality of higher education in this country. We look forward to a more closer and fruitful association between these two neighboring universities. I think we have to live together as institutions, as neighbors, and there is a lot to share among ourselves. I have been placed in the company of vice chancellors just about a month back. And within this short period of time, believe me, I have fully realized what a difficult task it is to run a university with sincerity and expected devotion and dedication. It also develops amongst us a mutual appreciation and realization that there is a great virtue in working together. From the very first meeting which we had in the National Planning Commission, I think this is the message I have given to all other universities, that let us work together. And it was very well received. Turning to IGNOU, we have today, sir, 445 programs on offer as on today. And these are developed by 21 academic schools, and also recently by some of the centers which we have established. The cumulative strength of our university just now, student strength, stands at 22,93,327 on 15th of November 2011. The programs are delivered through 67 regional centers. These include 47 IGNOU regional centers, 9 Northeast regional centers, 6 Army regional centers, 4 Navy regional centers, and 1 Assam Rifles. We have 3,324 learner support centers throughout the country. This is the cutting edge through which we operate. A very good network if it is strengthened. We have, sir, 46,134 academic counselors as on 15th of November. These, most of them, come from conventional universities like Jawaharlal Nehru University. So there is a great, common point between this. It is not that a feeling which goes around that perhaps, you know, distance education is operating in isolation from the conventional system. No, I think we are very much interdependent. When it comes to the numbers, we are there, and when it comes to for us to provide counselors, the conventional universities are there. We have 82 overseas partner institutions abroad. These include those who are with us under individual MOUs, Pan-Africa Network, UNESCO, and Rajiv Gandhi Fellowship. We have an enrollment of, this very interesting, and we feel proud about it, we have an enrollment of 3.5 lakhs under Gyan Deep, which is the army, and a registration of 1.25 lakh is under process with the Akash Deep, which is with the Air Force. We have also established about 19 centers with the Navy, and enrollment has yet to take place. It's a matter of pride that 6 IGNOU students got into civil service. These include 4 from Bihar, 1 from Delhi, and 1 from Bangalore. Now, three of them made it to the civil service during the first attempt itself. When people talk about our quality, when we talk about effectiveness of distance education, I think we should be able to project our figures very well. Our materials, I know for certain, are extensively used by most of the civil servant aspirants. I remember, sir, in 2000-2001, we suddenly saw a sale of materials going up to 1.5 crore. And we tried to find out that who has purchased it. They were all civil service aspirants. So, I mean, the material is there. The material, I think what we have to do is we have to maintain that quality of the material. It is an institution of great significance, sir, and of great importance, and has been built up over the years by who have joined us brick by brick. I think credit what we pose today, either in terms of numbers or in terms of programs, goes to each one of them who have worked very hard to take IGNOU where it is today. To me, research plays a very, very important role in the growth of any educational institution. I think we are making serious attempts to develop a research policy for IGNOU, and it is almost under finalization now. As approved by the Board of Management of IGNOU, we have instituted 100 fellowships of the value of 5,000 per month for doctoral research work, full-time PhD program on an annual basis. And these fellowships will be awarded to the candidates not receiving any other fellowship or financial support on a regular basis. I hope that the procedure for the award of these fellowships is being kept in place, and we hope that we will be able to notify them by mid-December. 2 of these fellowships are being reserved for a female and a male candidate from the families of the economically weaker sections of IGNOU staff. I think we have to keep our staff in mind. We cannot operate in isolation, and who are pursuing research on full-time basis at IGNOU. The procedure for the extension, we have large number of RTAs here. The procedure for the extension of RTA's tenure beyond the initial 3 years period has also been put in place by establishing what you were emphasizing also, procedure of rigorous evaluation of academic performance of the researcher, and by entrusting the assessment work to a respective doctoral committees, and the extension pro forma containing elaborate academic performance indicators have already been developed and kept in place. So they will have no complaint with us. We are also exploring ways and means to help IGNOU student financially. I am grateful to Sherry Hashbal, Chairman and Managing Director of the National Handicapped Finance Development Corporation, who came for a meeting with me just yesterday, and immediately through NCDS we were able to identify 9 IGNOU students who are fulfilling all the necessary requirements which they have laid down, And as he has rightly announced, that scholarships will be given to all these 9 students. We will certainly, I assure Mr. Bahal, we will certainly popularize this scheme through our network of regional centers and open universities. They have a lot of scholarships. Why can't we help them in spreading that message? We have also, sir, an ICT policy under preparation. All future ICT related interventions will be taken up within this policy framework. Because otherwise, you know, we don't know where it will carry us. It's so much, we are so much under pressure, all sides under the ICT cover. In order to improve quality of our programs, we are reintroducing our phase-wise development of various programs with strict quality control. Because we would like not to lose track of the quality. We are taking a stock of all the projects taken up so far formally, maybe close those which have been already completed, and pay special attention to those who are still ongoing. Because if you take a project, I think logically you have to take it to its logical end. We have also taken a review of all the national and international MOUs which we have signed and take corrective measures to make them effective and relevant. Because that, on that depends our international image, particularly those which we have signed with partner institutions across 40 countries. We have already, sir, conducted within shortest period of time 2 in-house training programs, one for PIOs under our RTA program and one for our drying and dispersing officers, namely the directors. I think these programs, you know, significance of these programs here, they are expected to improve the internal financial management and also help us to promote transparency in our operations. Now we have to work together, sir, within the and outside university framework. Within, when I am talking of, to further improve our efficiency, and outside, when we talk of IGNOU, not only to work with the conventional university system face to face, to face the challenge of education, we have also on one hand a network of state open universities. I think it's our responsibility that we take all necessary steps for capacity building of these institutions, on the one hand. On the other hand, we have institutions like National Institute of Open Schooling. Now, we cannot say that we don't know each other. I personally feel that while as state open universities can become our extended arms, in the national course of events which the course they take, the output of National Institute of Open Schooling could become the input for IGNOU. They have an output of 2.5 lakh students every year who could easily become input for our admissions. I have preliminary discussions with the chairman of the NIOS. We have agreed that even our prospects for admission will be displayed by them and provided to the outgoing students from National Institute of Open Schooling. These are ways which does not cost us anything. We have also a large number of directorates of distance education, sir, in the conventional system, number of, you know, universities. I think we have almost 207 directorates of distance education. And we have to work, we have to strengthen them also. We have to work in close cooperation with the conventional university system. I think only working together will facilitate us to face the challenge of reaching large unreached without compromising quality. I'm happy, sir, that the organizers of this function today thought of introducing this Foundation Day pledge. It is not that all of us are not working sincerely, it is not that all of us are not working with dedication, but it is a reminder for all of us to serve this great seat of learning with needed dedication and sincerity. That's why, you know, so many pledges are taken every year for various things, and I think it's a very good idea that we dedicate ourselves to this institution which has been taking care of us for decades now together. I hope that we will come up to the expectations which founders had in mind when they established this institution. I am grateful to the members of our statutory bodies and distinguished guests to have made it possible to attend this function. I am grateful to the IGNOU community in general and organizing committee in particular to have made it possible to organize this function successfully and made all the arrangements for successful conduct of this function. I'm equally grateful to the cultural groups and our beautiful children from the creche who will be performing after this formal function is over. Thank you for participating in this 26th Foundation Day celebration. I thank you all. Thank you very much.
थैंक यू सर. इस कार्यक्रम का समापन धन्यवाद ज्ञापन से होना है. कुल सचिव श्री टोलिया को ये जिम्मेदारी मिली थी पर उनकी तबीयत ठीक नहीं है. बड़े प्रयासों से वो यहाँ बैठे हुए हैं तो ये जिम्मेदारी निर्वहन करने का भार मेरे कंधों पर है. गलती अगर हो जाए या किसी का नाम छूट जाए तो मैं उसके लिए माफ़ी मांगता हूँ. प्रोफेसर सोपोरी के हम लोग बहुत शुक्रगुजार हैं कि उन्होंने वक्त निकाला, हमारे साथ इतना समय बिताया, फाउंडेशन डे लेक्चर भी दिया और हमारे इस कार्यक्रम में शिरकत भी की. जिस तरह की इग्नू तक आने की सड़क है और जो उसकी दुर्दशा है उसमें ये बड़े साहस का काम है किसी के भी द्वारा स्वीकार करना. हम केवल ये उनको आश्वासन दे सकते हैं कि एक आध महीने में जो काम चल रहा है वो पूरा हो जाएगा, फिर यहाँ आना बहुत सुगम होगा और हम बार बार उनको यहाँ बुलाना चाहते हैं. मिस्टर बहल ने बड़ी अच्छी शुरुआत की है. विश्वविद्यालय इस समय डिफरेंटली एबल्ड स्टूडेंट्स के लिए काफ़ी काम कर रहा है. अभी कुछ दिनों पहले इंडियन साइन लैंग्वेज इंस्टीट्यूट की बुनियाद रखी गई थी. हमारे बहुत से विद्यार्थी जो हैं वो डिफरेंटली एबल्ड हैं और हमारे साथ यहाँ अध्ययन कर रहे हैं. अगर उनको वित्तीय सहायता मिल जाए तो बड़ा सपोर्ट हो जाता है. मिस्टर बहल ने इस तरह की शुरुआत की है, हम उनके बहुत बहुत आभारी हैं. इस तरह का आयोजन विश्वविद्यालय के तमाम विभागों द्वारा मिलजुल कर ही हो सकता है. जो साज सज्जा आप स्टेज पर देख रहे हैं वो हॉर्टिकल्चर डिपार्टमेंट की है. डॉक्टर यादव ने बड़े प्रयासों से ये सब जमा किया है. ये सब फूल जो हैं ये विश्वविद्यालय की अपनी संपत्ति हैं, कुछ भी इसमें बाहर से नहीं मंगाया गया है. ईएमपीसी इस सारे कार्यक्रम को टेलीकास्ट कर रहा है. ये जो आवाज़ हम लोगों की आप तक पहुंच रही है ये सब प्रयास उन लोगों का किया हुआ है, हम उनके बहुत बहुत शुक्रगुजार हैं. और इस तरह का काम एडमिनिस्ट्रेटिव और फाइनेंशियल सपोर्ट के बिना हो नहीं सकता. पांडे जी छुप के कहीं बैठे रहते हैं, कभी भी हमारा धन्यवाद स्वीकार नहीं करते हैं. जहां पर भी हैं मैं उनका बहुत शुक्रगुजार हूं कि उन्होंने इसको सपोर्ट किया. और चूंकि ये बात मैं टोलिया साहब के बिहाफ पे कह रहा हूं इसलिए मैं उनका क्या शुक्रिया अदा करूं कि एडमिनिस्ट्रेटिव सपोर्ट उन्होंने हम लोगों को प्रोवाइड किया. बच्चे एक छोटा सा सांस्कृतिक कार्यक्रम इसके बाद पेश करना चाहते हैं. हम लोग नेशनल एंथम के लिए अभी खड़े होंगे और उसके बाद वाइस चांसलर साहब बच्चों को कुछ चॉकलेट बांटना चाहते हैं जो उन्होंने अपने आप मंगाई है. विश्वविद्यालय की वित्तीय सहायता से ये चॉकलेट नहीं आई है. तो हम लोग नेशनल एंथम के लिए तैयार हो जाएं और उसके बाद फिर हम धन्यवाद. छोटे बच्चे मैं